Hello again, this is LaZouche Custom here. Right, well, quite a while ago I did a review on a friend's full metal customised Tokyo Marie SIG 226 and was quite enamoured by that particular gun. I got to admit I did like the wood grips and so forth. And as, well, fate, luck, whatever you want to call it, sort of came along, I managed to get hold of a second-hand version of the original TM plastic 226 that was released a number of years ago now. They have actually brought out an updated version, which is the E2 version, which has slimmer grips and feels better in the hand. And personally speaking, I think looks better as well, but it's only like odd little bits here and there that differ it from this particular version. So they can do for both. The internals are identical, there was no change. Right, what do I think of the pistol? Well, without going on about my friend's custom version, which I was rather spoiled on, I'm going to do this as if, you know, it's just purely on this gun, not on what you can do to it or whatever, out of the box. So what do I think of it? Well, overall, it's quite a large gun in the hand. I mean, I've got fairly long fingers, quite a large hand, but it still feels large, especially across here, where your palm swell goes. It doesn't feel comfortable to me. But don't get me wrong, that's purely my own view. A lot of you out there do like these particular guns and find them very ergonomic, so don't just go on my own personal view on this sort of idea. But yes, for the feel, it's a large pistol in the hand, so, you know, take that into consideration. If you're small-handed, it might not be the thing for you. However, to actually hold the gun and its ergonomics, it's clean lines, it's quite nice. You can fit a torch on the front. If I get a torch around here somewhere, I should have one. There we go, an M3, standard M3 torch, which I believe most of you out there have got. You can fit it quite snugly. In fact, that's very snug. This is the first time I've fitted an M3 torch to this, so this is a bit new ground for me as well. And it's quite snug on there. In fact, it's damn good. So yeah, it's pretty good. Actually, my battery, there we go. It's pretty good for flicking the torch on and off. Yeah, it's pretty good. You can get to it quite easily. So, and that goes if you're a left-hander as well. You can, if my torch would work, that is, there we go. It's pretty good. So you can fit a laser on there, you can fit a torch on there quite snugly indeed. The pistol itself is quite heavy. Especially with the magazine in. When you take the magazine out, it's still fairly weighty, but not to any great degree. In fact, I would say that a 1911 is heavier than this without the magazine in, than what this one is. I'm not sure whether there's any metal weights up inside the grips. I don't believe there is, actually. No, it doesn't look as if there is. No, there isn't. There isn't any weights up in those grips. So, yeah, there's no actual weight at all in these plastic grips at all. I believe the inner frame is metal, but anyway, I'll come to that in a minute when I strip it down and show you how the internal workings work and so forth. But in the actual grip itself, there is no metal. That said, the magazine, when inside the gun, gives it that weight and is quite robust. The magazine itself is quite well marked. Again, I'll come back to the markings as well on the main pistol, but as you can see on the magazine, you've got SIG Sauer 9mm, made in Japan. Well, yeah, fair enough, because it is Tokyo Marie. But other than that, there's no other markings on there at all. The magazine itself is a good gas capacity, very, very good, equivalent to a higher Kappa, maybe slightly less, but overall pretty good. However, there are drawbacks to this particular design of magazine, namely this, which is the join line of the base to the top section. It's screwed, which is a benefit, at least it isn't pinned together, which is a real pain if they are. especially the higher capacity magazines that you get for the high capper and Glock and so forth. They're always pinned, but these ones are pretty good. So there is, you know, there is the option that you can, you know, sort of tighten that up if need be. If it starts to leak around there or whatever, it's either because the weather is very, very cold and the rubber seals are shrinking and thus letting the gas out, or it's because it's bone dry and needs some lubrication. You know, have a look at any of my magazine maintenance videos or whatever to see what you do in order to get the seals and everything else to work correctly. So I won't sort of go into details with this because this is just about this particular gun. But these magazines with that design are not the best. So reliability wise, not the best. I keep seeing these magazines leaking all around here and at different events that I've been to where people have brought these particular guns, they always complain about them leaking. So yeah, it's can be a bit of a bugbear with this particular design of magazine. But apart from that, the ejection valve and the fill valve are all standard TM quality, so they're pretty good. There's no problems there at all. You can buy upgraded ejection seals or whatever, ejection valve seals, nozzles, which are always handy, especially the 9-ball purple ones, which will add a little bit more velocity to the gas that escapes. So yeah, you can buy upgraded valves as well, because they're all identical to the, at least I think they are, mind you saying that, no, I don't think they are actually. These are slightly different valves to what you find on a high capper. But that said, you know, you can buy upgraded valves as far as I know. There is another little drawback in the fact that the lips are easily broken because there is quite a proportion of plastic that is sticking out here, which goes for any of the TM magazines really. The mag lips are easily broken if dropped, thus they will break. But replacement parts are easily available. So there you go. Metal base, very, very good, quite robust. In fact, it is very robust. Even if you drop it on that edge, it's not liable to break because it's all part of the one moulding. So it's pretty good. I've got to admit they have done their homework on that particular area. So, and good BB capacity as well. You can fit, I think it's something like 26 BBs in there, something like that. Not as many as a high capper, but not bad. No, in fact, I think it's slightly less than 26 BBs in there, but yeah, it's not bad. I mean, yeah, if you're into how many BBs you carry, then it's quite a high capacity. Right, markings. Now then, you've got all the markings. SIG Sauer P226, stainless, SIG Arms Incorporated, Exeter, New Hampshire, USA. You've got 226 marked on the grip. And if you turn it over, again, you've got SIG Sauer written on that side. You've got on the outside of the barrel 9mm para or Parabellum. Then you've got Tokyo Marui Co. Limited, made in Japan, which is a bit of a shame, but still they've got to put it somewhere, I suppose. But yeah, so they've stuck it there. Then you've got the standard ASGK U658 code or serial number or whatever written on the side of the frame. But other than that, there are no other markings on here whatsoever. So it's pretty bland when it comes to markings, but for what they've done, at least they've put the SIG Sauer 226 on there, which is pretty good. Controls, all full readily to hand. It's a double action trigger pull, so it's quite a heavy trigger. In fact, it's very heavy. However, when it has been pulled for the first shot, obviously the slide will load another BB in and cock it ready to fire for the next shot. Your secondary shots are quite light. So the first shot is heavy, but once it's reloaded itself, it's not bad. There is an excessive amount of trigger distance to pull, even on single shot. There is an excessive amount, more so than what you'll get on a 1911. I have to admit, and this goes for real steel as well, you cannot beat the 1911 trigger. It is the best in the world, as far as I'm concerned, because you can set it up to whatever you want. Well, it's not just as far as I'm concerned, that's a general rule. Double action triggers are heavy, clunky. You've got to get used to them. So they are not good for target or, you know, sort of professional sportsman's type pistol usage. For standard skirmishing and warfare or whatever, or, you know, law enforcement use, whatever, yeah, that's fairly handy because you're under stress. You know, that heavy trigger pull is guaranteed. If you're under stress, you want to pull that trigger, you're going to pull it. But when it comes to target, they want fast resets and so forth. So, yeah, it's, you know, it's not the best. So, yes, trigger pull heavy. There is no grip safety, which is another bonus, actually. I quite like that, the fact there's no grip safety. You have got a slide lock, which is there, which is in a weird place. That's why, and this is a good case to show it, I always say when you're going to load a pistol, which is exactly the same as many of the real steel instructors say, is to grip the back of the slide thus with your thumb towards your face and do that. All right, because that way you've loaded every pistol in the planet. So, say it's this one, the SIG 226, 1911, Glock, whatever, grab it there, round just either side with your fingers on like the side of the slide on one side, palm on the other, pull it back towards you, you've loaded the pistol. You don't have to hunt around for where the slide lock is or anything, because in this one it's at the back here. On a 5.7 it's the other way round. On a Glock it's, I think, midway, and if it's on a 1911 it's where the takedown lever is on this particular SIG. So there you go, it just goes to show the easiest way to load a pistol is to do that. Alright, so it's just a universal loading tip there. Right, coming back to the review. So your slide lock is there, but there is another nifty little device on this, which I think I did show you on the custom version of my friends, is this, which is your decocker. Now then, I'm going to prove it. Put a magazine in. Now officially, when I pull the trigger, that gun should go off, but don't want to fire any more rounds, so I put my finger or thumb on this particular thing here, pull it down, and it decocks it without the thing going off. But if you want to fire it, because you know there's a BB already in the chamber, you just pull the trigger and it will go off. But it will go into double action first. So a handy little tip, or little nifty feature, is that decocker. I do look quite like that. Okay, how do you strip it down? Dead easy. You just pull that round. As you can see, the slide pops forward. You slide it straight off, and that's it. I'll come to the frame in a minute. There's your slide. It's pretty straightforward. There's no real sort of dramatic things to watch out for. You've got your blowback housing in there, which is standard sort of setup. That spring's a little bit weak, but then again it is second hand. So so your hop-up wheel adjustment is just there. Hopefully you can see this under the light. I'll brighten it up a bit. There we go. There's your hop-up wheel adjustment. I'm not going to touch it because it is set. But it's exactly the same as any other TM pistol, really. It's just that little hop-up wheel there. Other things, not really much to worry about, really. To strip it down, there is this little pin, which just seats into the front of the housing there. So it's dead easy to take your guide rod out. So it's really, really easy. And then you just slide the barrel out. Thus, like that, because you've got to take it out that way. You can't slide it all the way forward. You have to take it out that way. It's very hard to do this whilst looking down a camera lens at the same time, but there we are. So there's your sort of barrel or whatever, your outer barrel. It's quite short, actually, to be honest. I think it's very short. It's shorter than a high kappa 4.3, but there we are. Right, okay, let's slot all this back in if I can. This is the tricky bit now, where it all goes horribly wrong. Anyway, let's see if I can get that to go back through there, but you all won't. Right, okay. I did it once, but can he do it again? There we go. Ta-da! Right, you've got to be careful you don't pinch the spring in there. Oops, sorry, I'm going off camera. If you don't pinch the spring just as you're pushing the guide rod through. Right, okay, so there we go. You've got your outer barrel back in position. Now all you've got to do is slide it back on. Now then, actually I'll come to the frame. You may notice something very different about this frame. The slide rails are the opposite way round to what they are on a 1911. In other words, 1911 has got this design, yes, which is, you know, the slide rails or whatever on the slide are correct, but the rails on the frame are full length and completely right to the end of the dust cover. So the only gap you've got is where the magazine goes up through either side, but otherwise the rails continue the full length of the pistol, which gives it a very, very tight and smooth cycling action. It's very, very tight, very, very smooth, which is what I like, I've got to admit. SIG are very, very good for their accuracy on their pistols, so their design is yeah, spot on. So, oh, actually I might as well show you what's actually inside the frame. Inside the frame, you've got lots of little springs and so forth. I've never stripped one of these down yet, so I'm not liable to for the moment. I will do a strip down video, like I said I was going to do one on the Glock, which is coming. It is coming. I'm just waiting on getting a Glock 18C before I do it. But anyway, coming back to this, there's lots of little springs in there. There's your trigger bow, which goes all the way round. There's your decocker there, which uncocks the hammer for you. So the trigger bow is only on one side. It's not on both sides. It's only on one side of the frame, whereas a 1911 goes right the way round. But this one isn't. It's only on one side. And your disconnector is all sort of part of the trigger bow. So, yeah, combined. So there we are. So that's the interior. Now then, to put it back into position, you just click it back up, pushing it back so... Click that back up, and then that's it. It's back in position. So it's dead easy to strip this pistol down. Really, really easy. So there you are. So overall view of the gun is... I wanted one for my collection. So, that was the only main reason why I got it. I would not myself have gone out of my way to get one. But if you like the... sort of shape, design, SIG pistols, whatever, you like them, then yeah, TM is a good brand. It's the benchmark that any of the others are set by. The main failing with this gun, I think, is its plasticiness. It does feel plasticky. Compared to my friend's custom version of this, where he fitted a guard, a metal kit to it, it does add a hell of a lot to the gun. Not only does it give it weight, but it just makes it feel less plastic. This is... yeah, it's plasticky. But that said, if you're not worried about that too much, and remember, when the magazine's in the gun, it gives it weight, so that doesn't matter so much. Yes, fair enough, it does sound a bit naff, but the overall look, markings and everything else, the overall look of it is very, very acceptable indeed. In fact, it's very, very good. The quality of the plastic, the ABS, is not liable to break easily. In fact, I would say that it's quite robust. The only thing I would suggest is regards the rear sight area. There is one tiny little screw that holds that rear sight and the blowback housing in position. It's a weak point. So if you're going to use green gas in this gun a hell of a lot, that is what you've got to consider, because that will break exactly the same as the Glock one does. So how do you overcome this without too much expense? Buy metal sights. If you get some proper metal ones, although these are actually metal on here, but they're not the best, they're only pot metal. If you get the steel ones that either Garda or I think there's some other makes as well that produce them, fit them, because it will strengthen the fitment of the screw up a hell of a lot. You're also able to change out the foresight, so that's pretty good. So yeah, you can do that. Actually, the sights are pretty good out of the box. I've got to admit, the three dot, I do like that, but they are rather small. But yeah, overall they're pretty good. So you can swap out the sights. So yeah, as I say, the overall look is pretty good. It's acceptable. Reliability, top notch. There is no problems with this gun, as far as I know. The original owner who had it, who, funny enough, is the same guy who sold me my Glock a number of years ago now, and that one's still soldiering on. He has looked after this a lot. I mean, it's practically out-of-the-box condition. I mean, there's a little bit of dirt here and there, but other than that, there's no dings or bashes or whatever, or breakages in it. So it's done pretty well. It's had numerous numbers of rounds fired for it, because this was pretty much his main sidearm for quite a while. So reliability, functionality, usability, and everything else are highly recommended. It's top notch. Does have a heavy trigger. It is a bit sort of, if you're only used to 1911s, you're going to find it unusual as to where all of the different controls are, but it's learnable. You can get used to it. If you want it purely for the look, like you geardos out there, you know, to set off a particular camo loadout or whatever, then yeah, go for it. You can't do any worse than this. They are rather expensive, I know, TM, but at least it will be reliable. You don't have to worry about it too much. There is some issues, or there have been, when these first came out, to power and range. They are not as good as the latter TM designs that came out. I don't know why. I think it's something to do with the blowback housing, because it was a slightly different design to any of the others. So I think the capacity of the blowback housing is not enough to give it the maximum kick. That's why upgrades and so forth do help quite a bit. But as I say, out of the box, it's not bad. It's pretty good. It's reliable. Let's put it that way. It will do for a skirmish weapon. No problem at all. But if you want to reach out and touch someone from quite a distance, as you can with like a high capper or even a Glock for that matter, you're losing a few feet with this one. There's not so much power, or at least that's what I've found in others. So think about it. But overall, functionality, yep, all the parts work really well. You have already got a RizRail built in, and it looks far, far better than the one that's on, say, the Foliage Warrior, which personally I think looks hideous and doesn't resemble anything like a real steel, whereas this one is a real steel. It looks like real steel, so, and it's quite snug for any torches or lasers you want to fit. So, accuracy and range. Accuracy is pretty good. It's not bad, although my friend's already set this up how he wanted it set up, so I haven't touched it since. But shooting it indoors from about, I don't know, 20 feet away, something like that, 3-inch target, not bad. I'm getting a couple of flyers now and again, but otherwise it's pretty good. So for a standard skirmish weapon out of the box, not bad. For standard short range CQB, yeah, it's pretty good. Long range, don't know yet. My friend who sold it to me, I can remember him saying that, you know, it did reach out fairly well for most skirmish distances, but anything long range, yeah, purely because of the power issue. It's just not got enough oomph behind it to get a BB to go far. Can't even talk now. To go far enough for any great distance. So, you know, think about it. I think also with a short barrel as well doesn't help. Upgradability. Yes, there's loads out there. As I said before with my friend's custom version, there are metal kits available. There are grips available. You can get real steel ones. Obviously, they need a little bit of work, but you can get them to fit. Tight ball barrels, hop rubbers, piston heads, valve seals and valves as well, rubber seals or whatever. Yes, there are loads out there. So sights, yeah, you can upgrade to sights, you know, whatever ones you want. There are also chrome magazines available because there is a chromed version of this. I personally wouldn't touch it with a barge pole because it looks absolutely blingy, but it looks plasticky blingy. So this is plasticky, just stick chrome on it and it gets even worse. The Desert Eagle I thought was bad, the chrome version of that. This is even worse, the chrome version of this. It looks awful. I think the only time that Tokyo Marine ever did their chrome version any justice was with the Detonics, the small Detonics. That wasn't too bad. But other than that, and maybe their high capper 4.3 two-tone, that wasn't bad either. The high capper's not bad, but this one in chrome just looks awful. It really, really does. It looks like just a toy gun. It just don't look right at all. In that regard, there are a few mould lines here and there, which, yeah, not very good. Plasticky-wise, toy-wise, yeah. It was one of their early guns, so you can't really sort of complain too much. It rates alongside their very first Beretta M9 that they brought out. So if you know what that is, with like no hop adjustment and mould lines everywhere, this was like their one that just came after that, and it wasn't very good. So, yeah, if you want something that's perfect, yeah, you'll have to upgrade with metal kits and so forth. But that said, out of the box, usability, reliability, it's brilliant. So, upgradability, yes, as I said, there's loads out there, so, you know, you don't have to worry about that. So, cost effectiveness, yes, TM can be expensive, I know, for a plastic gun, but, as I say, the upgradability is there, so if you want to upgrade, you have got that option. Yes, it means more money, but you can turn a reliable pistol into something even better. So there you go. WE, I don't know of any other manufacturers that bring out the SIG 226 or have brought it out. I'm not sure, actually. But I know WE have brought one out, and it's WE. yeah, not the best. So, at least I think it's WE. If it's not WE, then I do apologise, but I'm sure it is WE that brought one out. But anyway, whoever it is, the aftermarket ones, I have handled one. So before you say, oh, you never handled one, I have handled one, but I wasn't sure whether it's WE or some other brand. I think it's WE. It rattled, like all WEs. So, yeah, but it was full metal, very, very heavy. And personally, as I say, I would not have gone out of my way to buy one. The only reason I bought this was just to see what they're like, and I was enamoured with my friends that I borrowed to do a review, so I thought I'd get one of these just to add to my collection. And to get used to another layout of interiors, because as I say, I'm hopefully going to do a strip down on this, the same as my Glock. So there you are. So, what do I give it a good recommendation? Yeah, not bad. It's not bad. It's plasticky, but they're all finicky things. There's nothing that's going to detract from what you're going to need the pistol for, which is in an airsoft game. If you like SIG, the look of them, it's going to complete a loadout, then you can't go wrong. It's going to do exactly what it says on the box, or on the tin, or whatever. It's going to do what it does, which is shoot your opponent. That's it. That's all you want. And do it fairly accurately. So, yeah, reliability, build quality, top-notch. As I say, TM, they're pretty good. They are the benchmark that all of the others try or strive to attain. So I would say these are good. Yeah, so that's it. So, yeah, it does get my recommendation. But try before you buy. Mainly for the grip size. It is rather large. It's a hand-filling grip, so it's pretty good on that front, I suppose, if you've got large hands. But if you've got small hands or sort of long-fingered hands, such as mine, then, yeah, it might not really be you. Trigger pull is very, very, in fact, excessively heavy. So think about that as well. Sights are small. Not a lot of upgradability on the sights, but that's, as I say, negligible. It does have a riz rail, however, built in, which is handy. And it's got good gas and BB capacity, so not too bad there. You can run it on green, but I wouldn't sort of do it on a very hot day, let's put it that way, but that stands to reason, it's common sense. Do not run this on red gas or even on the black gas either. That's another type of gas that I believe Garda have just brought out, or it's currently available. Yeah, I wouldn't run it on that. But green gas isn't too bad, Abbey Ultra, and obviously 1.348 if you can still get it. Nifty little features, handy in regards to the decocker. The strip down is dead easy, you can't go wrong with that. And the overall layout, i.e. the nice slide to frame fit, is very, very tight and very, very good. So, yes, it gets my recommendation. And value for money, not bad, not bad. But then again, you're buying for TM quality. So, yes, you pay a little extra, but you are going to get something that's worthwhile. So there you are. So hopefully you've enjoyed the video and the review. I shall try and put links below to where you can get the gun or whatever, and for any upgrade parts that I might come across whilst I was doing my research into this gun. So have a look below if you want to, you know, find out for metal kits and so forth. I'll see if I can put them in the description. If they're not there, then please, you know, comment or whatever, because obviously I've forgotten. Because sometimes these videos don't go up for about a week after I've done them. So, you know, so if there isn't a link below, please tell me, and I'll put a link. Anyway, so there you go, guys. So hopefully you've enjoyed the review, and as I always say, stay sharp, but stay safe. This is LaZouche Custom saying bye for